of them would not speak on the record in front of my TV camera. So when I receive a letter or email or phone call from a retired law enforcement professional who says he is still haunted by an encounter with a large unidentified aerial craft that occurred in 1992, I pay attention and I try to follow up. And that's what happened this fall with John M. Spaulding, who has given me permission to use his full real name. He was born in 1945 and is now retired at age 63 with a serious breathing disability that might be linked to his UFO encounter in 1992. He worked in law enforcement in Rumford, Maine, and the Colorado Springs region of Colorado from 1982 until 2001. He was a chief investigator for detectives when he retired because of his physical disability. In the late fall of 1992, he was working for the state police based in Colorado Springs. But to make ends meet for his family, he held another job in restaurant management at night. His strange story begins as he got into his car around 5 p.m. to go to the restaurant. It was nearly winter season and the sun had set, but the sky was still gray.
At that time, in 92, I had two jobs. I was a state police officer for Colorado during the day, and at night, I was a manager of a upscale restaurant and lounge in Colorado Springs. So my normal work hour in the evening is 6 o'clock until 3 in the morning. I was on my way to work. I was going to leave a little early that night. I wanted to eat dinner there at work before I actually went on shift. So I backed out of my driveway. My house sat across the street from one of the city golf courses there. When you get to that stop sign, you have to turn left or turn right. Of course, I always turn right. If you look down the end of that fairway is the tee box where people would tee off on that hole. And you always had to look down there because if you turn at the wrong time and somebody hit a ball, it might come through your windshield. So you look down there, and I looked up, and I noticed over the top of the trees and probably 1,000 yards away were what appeared to be landing lights of a large aircraft. Now, that portion of Colorado Springs is heavily military. You got Fort Carson on one end. You have Hint Air Force Base or Pete Field out on the far east side. And up north, you have the Air Force Academy. A lot of military around there. But flight patterns were not over our area. So this was not a normal flight pattern for any plane to be in. And I looked up at that plane, and it was only a couple hundred yards off the ground. And I'm thinking, my God, this guy's going to crash, and he's going to hit me. I can't get out of the way. And I kind of froze, to tell you the truth, and was looking at this thing. The longer I looked at him, the more I realized he wasn't moving very fast. I mean, he was moving extremely slow. I thought, what the heck is that? I couldn't figure it out. So I backed the car up a little bit, and I parked, and I got out, and I walked across the street, and there's a 6-foot chain link fence that separates the public from the golf course there. I leaned up against that fence, and I watched this, whatever it was, these two lights, and they seemed to be about 50 to 60 feet apart from one another. And it came over the top of these stand of trees on the opposite side of the fairway there on number 9. It came over the top of those trees, and it just stopped right there. And then it lowered itself to probably 50 feet off the ground, maybe. And the lights were there, but I couldn't see it. I could see the trees through it. I could see the sky through it, and I couldn't see this thing.
When you say you could see the sky and the trees through it, you mean through the light?
You have to picture this. If you had a light in your left hand, a light in your right hand, you extended your arm straight out, that space in between those two lights you could see through. It stopped for a second, and I thought, this thing's getting ready to move. It didn't turn. It stayed in the same position, but it moved slightly to the right or south. It stopped. I thought, I think it's getting ready to leave. So I jumped in my car, and sure enough, it started going down south, down the street, down the fairway. That area of town is heavily filled with two-story Victorian-type houses. And I'm thinking he's going to hit one of those houses. And I'm thinking he's going to hit that house at the end of the street. And he got to that house, and he stopped, and then he went up, over, and went, pew, and was gone. I'm telling you, in just the blink of an eye, he was gone. And whether he left or whether he shut off the lights and just sat there, I don't know. All I know was it was gone. So, thinking, I don't know what that was, but I think I'll keep this one to myself. So, I went on to work and looked at my watch when I got to work. I hadn't lost any time to speak of, maybe 5 or 8 minutes. To the left, as you come in, there's an elevated, huge horseshoe bar that sets up there. And I noticed that there was a guy sitting at the bar, and he was facing me. So my dinner came, and I'm eating my dinner, and every once in a while I'd glance up, and the guy was just sitting there staring at me. And now I'm thinking, oh, I wonder if this is somebody I threw out of here a month or two ago. I don't know who he is. I finish my dinner, and I get up, and I clock in. I'm standing by the front door, and one of my cocktail waitresses comes up, and she has an issue. And every once in a while, I glance over, and the guy is still staring at me. Pretty soon, she leaves, and the guy gets up, and he walks over to me, and I'm thinking, oh, boy, something's wrong. And he said, can I talk to you? And I said, yeah, sure. He said, how about if we go outside? I thought, oh, the guy wants to fight now. I said, all right, let's go outside. So we went out in front of the building. He said, did you have something funny happen to you on the way to work tonight? And I said, why don't you tell me what happened to me on the way to work tonight? He said, well, we were just checking up on you. I said, oh, why don't you explain that? He said, well, let me explain this. He then stood there and proceeded to tell me about my entire life, from the day I was born to the present moment. And he never missed a thing. He knew everything about me, things I had forgotten about. Things that I had tried to keep secret in my life. He knew it all, everything. And then he said something that was kind of funny. He said, do you remember when you were about 6 or 7 years old, there was a strange light, red light, that came in through your parents' house in their front room window, and it illuminated your whole front room. Do you remember that? I said, no, I don't recall that. He said, well, we were checking on you then, too. He said, you're one of the special ones. And then he handed me a card. Business card. He says, if you ever want to talk to me again, you can reach me here. I said, okay, thank you. I stuck the card in my pocket, and he turned around and walked away.
Can you describe him?
Sure. He was about 5'11". I would say he weighed about 150 pounds, very thin. He had a beard, brownish hair, full beard and mustache. The color eyes, I couldn't tell you because he had glasses on, so I couldn't see his eyes very well. But he wore a pair of blue jeans, and he wore a plaid-type shirt. On top of that, he wore a leather fringe-type jacket. He had on boots, but they were not Western boots. They were square-toed. They were almost like a motorcycle boot, only nicer. He also wore a leather hat like you might see some of the guides wearing down in places like in Australia.
What color was the hat?
Kind of a tannish color. Kind of matched the jacket.
And the boots were black?
I think they were a real dark brown.
Did you say, how do you know details about my life?
Actually, I was flabbergasted. I was so stunned what this guy was telling me that I couldn't really say anything. But I was thinking things, and apparently he knew what I was thinking because he was saying things to me that I was thinking. The grass area at the golf course where this thing was apparently hovering, the grass and the roughage area there turned brown. And I noticed the next spring, they had come out and replaced all that sod in there, got rid of that brown grass, and that grass also turned brown.
And was there a shape to the brownness?
Kind of an oblong, like a big cigar. Seriously. And they changed that grass out in there for the next 3 to 4 years before I moved up to Fairplay. And every year it died out again. I mean, not at the time of year when it should die out. I'm talking spring, summertime, it was dead brown, where everything around it was just pretty green.
And the implication is that whatever the cigar craft was, it was radiating some kind of energy that went into the plants and the soil and stayed there.
That's my guess.
And when you think about the stranger, do you have any intuitive sense about whether he was human or not?
My common sense tells me he was, and my gut feeling says, and you kind of remember, I'm an old cop.
Right.
And my gut feeling says, I spent 20 minutes talking to somebody who is not from this world.
But why tie it to the phrase, you're one of